from the Jeannie Hayes Virtual Studio. This is Marquette Now.
Good evening. I'm Jackson Gross.
And I'm Liam McCartney.
Coming up, an exclusive first look at a new building.
Jewish high holiday season in full swing.
A pumped up weekend scaled down.
And later, fastballs flying on the court.
But before we get into all of that, we're a week removed from the convocation protests outside the Alumni Memorial Union, in which the Marquette community showed support for the students facing sanctions against the university. We're joined by Marquette Wire executive news editor Julia Abuzahab, who broke the news last week. Now, Julia, there's been a lot of buildup since the initial convocation demonstration. What's been the process of getting to where we are today?
So obviously, first, the students held a demonstration at the new student convocation, to which the university decided to send them through the student code of conduct process because they didn't follow the right protocols and guidelines that Marquette has in place to hold a proper demonstration. After that, the students were charged with several different things, and the students and many people of the Marquette community felt that this was unfair, so they decided to appeal this process and hold a protest last Wednesday.
So now, according to your recent article in the Marquette Tribune, students are facing a whole bunch of different consequences, and like you said, they're appealing those consequences. Now, can you kind of explain what the consequences these students are facing?
Yeah, so right now they're facing probation and suspension with abeyance. They're also facing having a $300 fine, 20 hours of community service. Some have to write an apology letter, and people also have to write an educational program about the demonstration policy, which they have to present to their student organizations.
So now, what can the Marquette community expect to come next out of this?
So at the moment, we're still kind of waiting for the university's decision on what they did with the appeal process. So hopefully in the next few days, we'll hear what their formal decision was, but definitely stay tuned because the Marquette Wire will provide updates hopefully soon.
Thank you so much, Julia. Can't wait to hear what comes up next in this whole story. Thank you. October marks the start of flu season.
Free flu vaccines are available every Tuesday in the Alumni Memorial Union ballrooms from noon to 2 p.m.
The Marquette University Health Clinic is administering the vaccines with help from the College of Nursing.
Australia has an early and severe flu season, and ours is expected to be as well.
It's really important to get the flu shot, especially this season, because not only do we have COVID still circulating, but we will be having the flu circulating, and it has started on campus already. Typically, we usually see it in November, December, when it really starts getting closed. Everyone's in close quarters. In Australia, it started really early, and we tend to go ahead and base what our flu season's gonna be like on what they get, and theirs was extremely severe flu season, and it was very early.
The new building for the College of Business Administration is nearly complete.
Marquette Now's very own Timothy Watteau takes us inside for the first time.
A new building, nearly finished.
Here we still have glass missing in a few spots. Painting still has to be done on the first and second floor. Lighting and some ceiling tile work is still happening.
Some work still happening on the four-story, 100,000 square foot building, the new home of the College of Business Administration. A new home with new features.
These are electrical outlets and data connections that will get sunk into the floor once we get our carpet installed, so it'll be a little more flush. They'll have some glass boards that they can write and do their presentation on.
This is Marquette's largest fully donor-funded construction project, all $60 million worth of concrete, steel, and glass. It's set to open to the public in December and for classes to be taught here next semester in the spring of 2023. Despite as far as it's come, it's sure had its fair share of challenges.
We had to think some things differently because of COVID. That tweaked a few of our designs, more on our classroom side. And then supply chain has been our other fun little game we're playing right now. We ordered all our steel on this project before the building was even designed.
Steel, check. Carpets, not yet.
My biggest worry is those supply chain items, like our carpet showing up.
Carpets or not, Kathy has shown up for
28 years. I've been here a while.
A worried veteran, but excited students.
I like to find like new study space, like spots, and I feel that this one is gonna be like a really, really cool one. So I'm excited to check it out.
You get a project, it's your child, till you see it all the way through. The whole process of raising a kid is similar to building a building.
Building a building, raising a roof, and plenty more components inside. I'm Timothy Lateau, Marquette Wire News.
The athletics department announces the passing of Senior Associate Athletic Director Aaron Baker on October 2nd. Baker joined the athletic department in 2002 and was an intern with the program for 19 years. Aaron is survived by his wife and five children.
Longtime chemistry professor James Kincaid passes away on September 26th. His 38-year career at Marquette includes being a Way Cleaner Fellow and department chair. He is also a Hagerty Award winner for research excellence.
I mean, he is somebody that, you know, I think from day one when I came here, I said, you know, that's who I aspire to be in terms of research.
Met him in his office and he's super, super nice. He made me really comfortable. You know, a person who came to interview usually would be nervous, but if you were in his office, he will make you know. He's so nice.
A pair of students have started up their own clothing swap organization. Student journalist Grace Cady tells us more.
The Rewear It clothing organization helps students practice sustainability.
Rewearing your clothes is like the best way to kind of be sustainable, but also be environmentally friendly.
These are some examples of the items of clothing that you can find on campus in the bins.
So my friend Elizabeth Grout and I started Rewear It. We were really interested in just like sustainability in general. Like students at Marquette don't have cars or ways to kind of or don't even know how to use the bus system, so they don't know how to go to thrift stores.
Students are invited to pick up new clothes from Rewear It.
I definitely kind of struggle with like online shopping addiction, so it'd be great to like be able to like swap clothes with someone and, you know, meet people.
So our donation boxes are usually set up a week before the swap. So we have a huge one that is set up in the AMU by the reception desk on the second floor. And we also have one at the Center for Peacemaking. And we swapped over 600 items of clothing, which is insane. And I think we saved over $4,000.
Make sure to check out Rewear It. I'm Grace Cady, Marquette Wire News.
Today is Yom Kippur, and the Jewish Student Union partners with Hillel Milwaukee to host several activities during the Jewish holiday season. Recently, the program puts together an activity station in the AMU.
Yeah, so right now we're in the 10 days in between Rosh Hashanah, which was last week, and Yom Kippur, which is next week. And so those are called like the 10 days of awe, which are days in which we like really focus our attention on things that we've done in the past year that might not have been so good. We also have dissolvable paper, and so we're inviting students to write down like maybe some bad habits that they want to break or things that they want to get rid of into the new year on those pieces of paper, and then we're physically casting them off into a body of water so that they literally and like figuratively will dissolve.
The Marquette University College of Nursing is coming off of receiving a big award a few weeks ago. The College of Nursing wins the Outstanding Achievement Award from St. Coletta of Wisconsin in recognition with the collaboration between the College of Nursing and St. Coletta's Intergenerational Care Center in Brooklyn and Brookfield, Wisconsin.
The yearly homecoming celebration takes place over the weekend. Marquette Now's Andrew Hubick is there to recap the event.
It's homecoming weekend. Usually, it's a celebration to look forward to with lots to offer. Past years have had big events and big crowds. But this year was different. headlining act Social House drew in a less than capacity crowd. And while Social House's magic got left in the Hamptons, the wishes of three students came true. Straight out of Marquette's music club, meet Three Body Problem.
It's going to be a fun experience, and, you know, it's a great way to start. We want to, you know, play a lot this year, and, you know, probably not places as big as this.
But giving us a taste.
Yeah.
Now we're going to chase the future. This.
And while Social House failed to turn heads, it didn't take long for Three Body Problem to draw a crowd.
I mean, this is the first time I actually feel invested in it since I'm like seeing all my friends play and stuff, so.
Yeah, we're super excited to see them. They've been practicing a lot, and so we came to show our love for them.
This year's festivities confirmed one thing. The students are the beating heart of everything Marquette. Even when there wasn't much else to get excited about, the students still came out to support their own.
Well, the students make them.
Yeah, I guess there wouldn't be one without them.
Andrew Hubick, Marquette Wire News.
The Marquette Filmmakers Association hosts their annual pitch night in Johnston Hall.
Members gather to share their own ideas or join other projects.
Dozens gather in the basement of Johnston Hall to collaborate. The films will be made in the next 2 months.
Pitch night in general is just like, it's my chance to get my idea across. So same thing for all the other students. It's their idea, their chance to get their ideas across and just like speak to a very broad audience.
Finished projects will be shown at the end of the semester. Some believe it's just the start of a longer journey.
It's better than more than half of the films that I've seen at festivals.
This is what I want to do for the rest of my life, and I hope I find like-minded people, and I hope they enjoy what they do as well.
I'm Nancy Flaherty here with your current weather report. Let's take a look. Right now it is currently 65 degrees here in Milwaukee. Humidity is at a cool 49%. And precipitation has a 0% chance of appearing this evening. Winds are coming from the west-southwest at 7 miles per hour. That's it for now. We'll be back with more after a quick break.
Before we celebrate the freedom most Americans have, we must fight for the freedom all Americans deserve. Because all lives can't matter until Black lives matter.
There are a lot of ways to reach out to a friend about their mental health. Learn how you can help at seizetheawkward.org.
Meet the scan, a simple procedure whose mission is to detect lung cancer early.
I'm here to save you.
But I feel fine.
That's great, but you may still be at high risk for lung cancer.
Oh man, that's a new fence.
If you smoke, early detection could save your life. Learn more at savedbythescan.org.
It all can get so out of control. Sometimes you can lose your faith, you can lose your mind, lose your grip, get stripped of your pride, till you don't know how you're gonna stay alive. Hey, hey, I got you. I will give you what you need, and I'll be right there. I got your back, I got you.
Welcome back to Marquette Now, I'm Nancy Flaherty. Tonight, it's 53 degrees and mostly cloudy. Humidity is at 72%. Precipitation is at the same chance of me meeting Barbara Streisand this evening, a big old goose egg. Winds from the west-southwest at 7 miles per hour. Let's take a look at our state overnight lows. We're going to be keeping in the 40s up here in northern Wisconsin, and then we're going to be hitting down at 51 in Madison and 53 in Milwaukee. Keeping it cool, Wisconsin. Tomorrow's highs, we're going to be bringing it up in the Superior and Minocqua, both at 49, keeping in the mid-50s throughout the state, and leading with 66 degrees in Madison and 54 in Milwaukee. Tomorrow, it's going to be 64 degrees, humidity at 60%, precipitation has an 80% chance. Grab your raincoats, Marquette, because also the winds are coming from the northwest at 13 miles per hour. Looking into our extended five-day weather forecast, we're going to be keeping in that high 50s range, keeping an increasing temperature later in the week. That's all for our weather forecast this evening.
Cobain Hall Resident Assistants host community nights for residents to bond, learn more, and have fun.
But some RAs are looking to take their community nights to another level.
Last Thursday, the RAs at Cobain Hall host Dodgeball, strengthening bonds but weakening bodies.
We came up with the idea quite a while ago, and we thought, you know, we got some approval and over at Healthfare. Instead, last minute, we kind of had to come here. It took a lot of, you know, working things out, reorganizing. Same thing with dodgeballs. We had to run around the city to get some dodgeballs, and glad it could all come together at the last minute and really get out here and have a good time with our residents.
It was a activity that required a lot of quick thinking, to say the least. There was a good few conflict that we kind of had to settle on the fly there, but it all worked out in the end.
While animals are not normally welcomed at Mass, today it is encouraged. We join Marquette Now's Jolan Cruz amongst the newly christened critters.
The Marquette community celebrates the feast day of Francis of Assisi with song, prayer, and furry friends.
Marquette Campus Ministry and the Canterbury Fellowship invited family, friends, and faculty to bring their beloved pets to the St. Joan of Arc Chapel this past Tuesday. The blessing, led by Father George, marked the first blessing of the animals for him here at Marquette.
We got to do a blessing of the animals today. We used an Episcopal liturgy and prayed with a bunch of people from, I think, a bunch of different faith backgrounds, and got to see these wonderful dogs primarily. Pray over them, give thanks for all the joy that they give to people around them, and kind of just have a good old time seeing a bunch of pets.
A Canterbury fellow visits with his family for the blessing of their new dog, Sammy.
In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and a great dimness covered the face of the deep.
I'm teaching the theology department, and I'm part of the Canterbury Fellowship, which is what Father George is connected with, so that's how I found out about it.
A total of six dogs were blessed. Even Father George wanted his cats to be a part of the unique Mass.
I've got two cats. I brought photos of them to be blessed because I'm commuting from Madison, Wisconsin.
Special guest Blue the Marquette police dog took a break from his patrol to join the ceremony.
Oh God, you have made us and all living things. We thank you for giving us these pets. You bring us so much joy.
Father George says he hopes the ceremony returns next year for another chance to put some paws together in prayer. I'm Jalon Cruz, Marquette Wire News.
The East Town Association hosts their final Jazz in the Park event of 2022. Hundreds of people come to enjoy free music each week. The event is held every Thursday and will return next summer.
Visitors to the Milwaukee Public Museum are treated to a limited-time narwhal exhibit. The exhibit has been on display since July.
Narwhals haven't been kept in captivity for nearly five decades. Many details about the animal are still unknown.
This exhibit explores the intersection of science, scientific research specifically on the narwhal, as well as the culture that is most closely connected to this particular animal, and that is the Inuit people.
Narwhals have the longest tooth in the animal kingdom. The exhibit is now closed and has been moved to the Bell Museum in St. Paul, Minnesota.
From the line of the mouth, and it actually grows through the upper lip.
That's it for now, but don't go anywhere.
London Davis will be back with sports right after this.
after you joined our family, it was like, I really do feel complete now.
Welcome back. I'm London Davis with your Marquette Now Sports Report. The men's basketball team is hosting an open scrimmage this Saturday at 10 a.m. at the Al McGuire Center. The men's program is also hosting three other events before their season kicks off. These events include a staff open practice on October 14th at 2 p.m. Also at the Al, an open practice at Pfizer Forum on October 27th at 6 p.m. and a blue and gold fun tip-off luncheon on October 31st at the Pfister Hotel. Hoping to stay perfect in Big East play, the Marquette volleyball team welcomes in Providence. The Golden Eagles open up with a hot hand and rally 18 kills to win the next first set 25-14. In the second set, Marquette is off to a slow start but find a groove and pick up the win 25-16. The Golden Eagles finish the match strong, sweeping the Friars and stay undefeated in Big East play. After sweeping Providence, Marquette moves up to number 18 in the latest AVCA poll. After suffering their first Big East loss, the Marquette men's soccer team looks to get back in the win column today at Villanova. Both teams start out slow, but Villanova finally finds the back of the net in the 60th minute, courtesy of senior midfielder Victor Benedictson. Although outshooting the Wildcats 25-17, the Golden Eagles dropped their third straight game 1-0. Hoping to avoid back-to-back losses, the women's soccer team welcomes in the UConn Huskies to Valley Fields. The Huskies jump out of the gates firing early, scoring their first goal in the fifth minute of the match, coming from a header by junior midfielder Lucy Capodona. After taking one shot attempt in the first 20 minutes of the game, senior Katie Coker beat UConn junior goalkeeper Caitlin Mahoney, tying the match in the 30th minute. Coming out of the halftime hot, UConn's Jada Conte maneuvers past Marquette's defense, scoring a goal in the first 31 seconds of the second half. The Huskies go on to win the game 2-1 and give the Golden Eagles their first back-to-back loss of the season. Coming up this week in athletics, women's soccer travels to Seton Hall on Thursday to take on the Pirates and will try to avoid three straight losses. Women's volleyball looks to stay undefeated in Big East play this weekend when they play the St. John Red Storm on Friday night and the Seton Hall Pirates on Saturday night. And men's soccer continues their 2022 season on Saturday morning against the Providence Friars. That's it for sports, but don't go anywhere. Marquette Now will be right back with our Down to the Wire segment.
Sophia and Gabriel, even though these old knees can't follow on your adventure to the forest today, these flowers represent my love. These stitches and threads join us together. And wherever you see a flower, a bird, a beautiful tree, know that my love is with you.
Make the forest part of your story at a park near you.
Welcome back. I'm Jackson Gross.
And I'm Liam McCartney. Marquette Wire executive news editor Julia Abuzahab joins us now for tonight's edition of Down to the Wire. She's with executive opinions editor Grace Cady to talk about her column in yesterday's edition of the Marquette Tribune.
Thanks, Jackson Milliam. How are you doing tonight, Grace? Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
So last week in the Tribune, the opinion section had an overarching theme of just women and women's empowerment. Can you kind of talk about why you chose that as a theme and just what the formal name was?
Yeah, absolutely. So it was called The Young Woman's Dilemma, and it basically dealt with different issues that young women face in society. And this ranges from like on a social spectrum, in their careers, just really in everyday life. So the really interesting thing was that all of our columnists attacked different issues. So we had things ranging from my column, which was called Wear Pink, Care About Politics. That was really about being rooted in your femininity, but also having interests in world and political issues. And then we also had another columnist who wrote about women supporting other women instead of attacking each other. We had one write about women's role in society and how they're really pressured to settle down and have children and get married on a different level than men are. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to come up with a theme that encapsulated women's issues on a broad spectrum, and I think we did that, so.
And like you said, you wrote an article about Wear Pink and Care About Politics. Can you kind of explain why you chose that as your theme and a little bit into what inspired you for that story?
Yeah, absolutely. So the title was inspired from the Miss Americana documentary, which is Taylor Swift's documentary. And towards the end, she has a quote in which she says, "I want to wear pink and tell you how I feel about politics." And it's basically talking about how she wants to be able to exist on a spectrum. She mm-hmm. wants to be able to be in the music industry and also care about politics and what's going on in the world. And I think that that, although specific to her, is general for a mm-hmm. lot of women. I think that in general, the idea is perpetuated a lot that if women are rooted in their femininity or if they mm-hmm. care about pop culture, fashion, their appearance, that means they can't really take an interest in important and major world issues. And I obviously wrote an opinions piece really disagreeing with that narrative. So that was where the inspiration came from.
Why do you think today that women can't wear pink and care about politics?
Yeah, so like I said, I think that women are just kind of put into a box sometimes with their mm-hmm. identities. I think that you look at a girl who is really feminine and girly and likes to do her makeup and hair and assume that she can't be into sports or she can't be into politics, she can't be into science. And mm-hmm. I think that it's a really ignorant perspective to have mm-hmm. because I don't think there's any reason that people's identities should be mutually exclusive. I don't think that you should have to care about one thing and not the other. And I think young women are scrutinized a lot in society just for their interests in general, and I think it falls under that as well.
And why do you think it's important for everyone to change this narrative?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that it's so important because I just think in order for women to really maximize their opportunities mm-hmm. and be rooted in their identities and true to themselves, that they should be able to explore whatever they're interested in and pursue all of their passions. And I don't think that we should be raising young women and girls to believe that they have to do one thing or the other, that they can only wear pink or care about politics, not both. I think that girls should really be able to do whatever they want with their lives and be motivated by the people around them instead of insulted.
And those are all the questions I have for you today. Thank you so much for joining
me. Thank you for having
me. And I'll throw it back to Jackson and Liam in the studio.
Well, that's our report for tonight. Thanks for joining us. I'm Jackson Gross.
And I'm Liam McCartney. Remember to check out MarquetteWire.org for all the latest campus news. Good night, Marquette.